Tonight I want to speak on the subject of peace. And I want to speak on the subject of peace not only in the world, but in your life, in your family, your community, your neighborhood, in your place of work. In the book of James, the fourth chapter, we take our text, James 1, 4, 1 and 2. From whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence, even of your lust and war in your members? Ye lust and have not, you kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet ye have not, because ye ask not. Where do these wars come from? People are asking that constantly, and what can we do about it? Because it seems that tonight the world is on the very edge of another precipice that could take us even to Armageddon itself. There's a climate of fear. A world seems to be almost out of control. In some countries, they're facing economic ruin. In some parts of the world, they're fighting political and social forces which seem to be pushing the world relentlessly to the brink of chaos. Am I a pessimist or an optimist? Which are you? I was walking in the dining room in Washington some time ago, and there were two senators sitting there at the Senate dining room, and they were having a discussion, and one of them called over and said, Billy, which are you, an optimist or a pessimist? I said, I'm an optimist. And they said, why? I said, because I've read the last chapter of the Bible, and I believe that God is in control of our world. I heard about two convicts looking out of a cell window one night. The pessimist saw the bars. The optimist saw the stars. But terrorism and war have become one of the sober realities of our world. An American television network recently did a long study on the Middle East on television at prime time, and they entitled it Near Armageddon. Yet, we're thankful that we're not yet at Armageddon. Someone has said, peace is that brief, glorious moment in history when everybody stands around reloading. Why can't people live in peace? What causes wars? Jesus said, for from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts and adulteries and murders and thefts and covetousness and wickedness and jealousies and all the rest. The things that cause war come out of our hearts. You don't have to read the newspaper to read about wars or to see wars. There are fights in the school playground, quarrels in your family. Most murders in the area that I come from are committed within families. Even a tug of war in your own heart. And it would be wrong to concentrate on nuclear disarmament alone if we don't see other wars among men. Racial wars, class wars, bitterness in politics, cutthroat business practices, all kinds of things. Now, there are three kinds of peace spoken of in the Bible. First, there is peace with God. That's in the spiritual order. Peace with God. There's a more fundamental war going on in the world. It's the war against God. You say, well, I'm not against God, but God sees it as a war. We break his laws, we disregard all of his plans, and he sees us at war with him. And it started in the very beginning. When God created man, he created him perfect. He never meant that man would fight, that there'd be jealousy and hatred, or lust or greed, or hunger, starvation, or racism. He never meant that there would even be death. Man was to live forever in a paradise. But when God created man, he gave him a gift of freedom of choice. He didn't create you a robot. He could push a button and you would obey. You're not a computer. You're not a calculator that God pushes buttons and you obey. You make your own decisions. You make up your own mind. You have a will of your own. That's the way God made you. He made you in his image. not the physical image, but the moral image. And you have a right to choose the kind of life you want to live and the kind of destiny you want to have and where you want to spend eternity. Because whether you like it or not, you are going to live forever. The real you, the part of you that lives inside of your body that we call soul, a spirit, lives forever, either in heaven or hell. And you make the choice. God offers you His love and His mercy and His grace, and He gave His Son to die on the cross for you. But if you reject it, we make our own hell in this life and the life to come. So there must be peace made with God. Now, peace with God is simply bringing things back into order through the intervention of God by His Son through His Spirit. In Colossians 1 it says, and having made peace through the blood of the cross, by Him to reconcile all things unto Himself. When Christ died on the cross and shed His blood, that made it possible for us to be reconciled with God. And that's what this mission is all about. To get people to realize that they can be reconciled to God and have peace in their own hearts, peace in their family, peace in the neighborhood, and ultimately peace in the world. Because Ephesians 2:14 says, He is our peace, who hath made both one and broken down the wall of partition that divides us. Christ is our peace. If you want peace, come to Christ. If you want true peace, come to Christ. If you want to make a contribution to world peace, give your life to Christ, and that's the greatest contribution you can make. He is the only basis for making peace between God and man, the Bible teaches. Then secondly, there's the psychological order or peace of God. St. Augustine many years ago described it as the tranquility of order. In the Old Testament, there was a young man that God called by the name of Gideon, and he had a big army to go out and fight another big army, and God said, your army is too big, Gideon, you'll lose. And he finally cut it down to 300 men to go fight a major army, and he was very frightened. And God said, Gideon, relax, I'm with you. And Gideon built an altar and called it Jehovah Shalom. God is peace. Why? Because God was putting the whole thing together for Gideon. And God can put your life together for you. Your marriage, your relationships with friends or neighbors or fellow workers. Now, God does not remove the troubles and the difficulties in life. The Apostle Paul had a thorn in the flesh. We don't know what it was. It was some physical disability that he had. And three times he asked God to remove it. But God said, no, my grace will be sufficient. I'll be with you in the midst of your suffering. I'll be with you. And then we have a catalog of all the sufferings that Paul went through. God did not remove the harsh realities of life, but He gave him the grace and the strength and the power to go through them victoriously, so that when he was in prison, he could sing and testify. And right at the very last, before he was slain in Rome, he could shout triumphantly that he was ready to meet God. Jehovah Shalom says, if you put your life in my hands, I'll order it. I'll get it together the way I want it together. And if you will let me work things out, you'll have peace and you'll have a new life. Now, as Christians, Jesus said, I'm going to send you out as sheep among wolves. Can you think of anything more dangerous than that? Behold, I send you as sheep among wolves. But he adds something else. While in the midst of the wolves, Christ Himself will give you peace, and He will be with you to help you. Now, that is the Christian distinctive. That is what helps make us different than other people in the world. Christ is with us in the midst of our troubles and our difficulties and our hardships. We are not exempted from all the difficulties that other people have to go through. I'm sometimes alarmed about a certain trend in certain aspects of the church, especially in America, which suggests that God will make you always happy and healthy and wealthy if you come to Christ. That is not true. When you come to Christ, many times the difficulties increase. I'll tell you why. He says there are two roads in life. One is a broad road and one's a narrow road. And you make a choice. And when you decide to receive Christ and go through a narrow gate and go on the narrow road that leads to eternal life, you go in the middle of the broad road and you're going against the stream of humanity. And that brings friction and sometimes more difficulty than you ever had before. But God will be with you in the middle of it. The Bible teaches that we're going to confront harsh realities. Jesus said, count the cost. He said, if you are not willing to deny self, your own selfish ambitions and your selfish sensual pleasures, and deny yourself the wrong things and take up the cross, what does that mean? Jesus said, I'm going to die. Will you go and die with me? It's going to be very unpopular to hang on that cross. Will you go back to your school and back to your work and back to your neighborhood and take your stand for me? Even though they laugh at you and make fun of you and say things about you? That's what it costs to follow Christ in our present age. The Bible teaches that we're going to have to face that. And man by himself is limited. How are we going to handle it? Well, some of you will say, well, it won't happen to me, but it will sooner or later, because there comes a time when we all suffer. A problem can start like that. And sooner or later, we all die. Sometime, somewhere, there'll be that stroke or that heart attack or that knowledge that you have cancer eating at you, or a motor car wreck that can happen so fast that you cannot bat an eye. And we're all involved in all of this. But in the midst of whatever it is, Christ is with you if you know Him. Because you see, there's the peace of God. He said, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. No matter what you're facing, don't be troubled. Don't be afraid. I'll give you my peace. But in the midst of the storms of life, which are always going to rage, there's the peace of God if you have peace with God. That's yours. In Philippians, the fourth chapter, it says, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Now, this psychological peace does not come from evading or avoiding or manipulating. It comes supernaturally from God. Now, there's a third kind of peace, relational peace, peace on earth. When the angels came and announced the birth of Jesus Christ, they said, peace on earth, goodwill among men. Where did that go? Why haven't we had peace? Didn't Jesus come to bring peace, you say? And all these wars in these 2,000 years? Yes, but people misunderstood. They would have had peace had they received Him and believed on Him and followed Him. But they rejected Him. And we have rejected Him. We didn't talk about the Prince of Peace when the United Nations was founded. He was left out. We'll never have peace in this world until we take into account the Prince of Peace and make Him King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And the Bible says there's coming a day when every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord. And that day is coming. Yes, there's going to be a judgment for you and for me. You're going to someday stand before Almighty God. Every person here today and all of you that are watching by television, you will stand alone before God. Every thought that you've ever thought, every intent of your heart, every moral choice that you ever made that was wrong, every sin that you ever committed is going to be brought to light. The tapes are rolling, the film is rolling, it's all there, and you'll have to face it and give an account. It is appointed unto man once to die, and after that the judgment. The scripture says God has appointed a day in which he will judge the world by that man Christ Jesus. Are you ready for the judgment day? You can be, because you see, in spite of the fact that God is a God of judgment, he's even more a God of love. He loves you. He offers his mercy to you. He offers forgiveness to you if you come to the cross where Christ took your sins. You see, when Christ died on the cross, God put upon him your sins and mine. He became sin for us. He became guilty of our sins. He suffered the judgment for us. He took the hell for us. There is therefore now no judgment to them that are in Christ Jesus. If you're in Christ, I'm going to tell you something. If you're in Christ, you'll never be at that great white throne judgment. It's past for you. It's finished. When Jesus bowed his head and said on the cross, "It is finished," the way to heaven was finished. The way of salvation was completed. Not by my goodness, not because I go to church, or because I read the Bible, or because I'm a clergyman. He did it on the cross. And there are hundreds of you here tonight, and hundreds of you watching that have been baptized and confirmed, as I was. But when I reached about 16 or 17, I realized something was wrong. Something was missing. I really didn't know Christ for myself. Something was missing. What is it? It's that personal relationship with Christ in which you have repented of your sins and received him by faith, and he lives now in your heart. But there's coming a day. Jesus said, "Thy kingdom will come." His prayer is going to be answered. "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." That's never been answered. But it's going to be answered. "And he shall judge among the nations and shall rebuke many peoples, and they shall beat their swords into pruning hooks. And nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore." In the meantime, God expects us to work for peace. We have to do all we can to bring peace, because we do not know whether this is the end time or not. We do not know when the kingdom is going to come and take over the world. But the peace can begin in your life right now. You say, "What do I have to do?" First, you must repent of your sin. What does that mean? That means that you're willing to say to God, "I have sinned and I'm sorry for it. I'm willing to change my way of living." The second thing, receive by faith Jesus Christ into your heart and make him Lord of your life and Savior of your life. Thirdly, you're willing to follow him and serve him from this moment on.